Heisenberg principle only. It also works for hydrogen atom. You can play with hydrogen atom and put the classical kinetic and potential energy, but kinetic energy must be related to the potential, to the momentum, related to the characteristic scale, the Bohr radius by Heisenberg principle. You will get the ground state energy of hydrogen. So that's what is needed. So okay, we have this expression. What is missing here still is the expression for the radius. It means we should find the chemical potential. And of course, we know how to do it. This is the Jeanne multiplier. We have to meet the condition that we assume, that we have to the number of particles, which is n. It means that integral over psi zero squared d3r is equal to n. So when we put it here, we will have something like this. 1 pi, I already integrated over angles, divided by gn, and we have from 0 to some radius, okay, mu, maybe I will, mu minus r squared, I will put 1 half the front. Unfortunately, it is simple. This is 4 pi gn 1 half. This is r squared, so it is 1 third r 0 cube 2 mu. But we know what is r 0. Minus 1 over 5 r 0 to power 5. Yes? That was good. Okay, yes. So let me write this 1 half 4 pi over gn. And then we have this is r0 square, yes? We can do it this way or the other way. I don't know whether we should substitute. Let us first find mu. So we put 2 mu here to power 3, and here we have to power r0 is 2 mu to power 1 half and 3. This is power 3 half times 2 over 2 is 5 over 2. 1 third, 2 mu. Yes. Minus 1 fifth, 2 mu. Must be like this because 1 third minus 1 fifth is 15, and this will be 5 minus 3 is 2. Yes, so it is 2 over 15. So it is 4 pi divided by 15 and gn. Okay? Times 2 mu to power 5 over 2. So from this we have, remember, the square root of 2 mu is r0, so we can write this in another form. r0 to power 50. And this is equal to n, so we see the scaling, how r0 grows with n. r0 is 15 gn by 4 pi to power 1 over 5. So everything is unit of harmonic oscillator then. So we see that if we have, I don't know, 100,000 atoms.
There is something consistent. Is it the same n on the left hand side as the right hand side? Or is it different n?
for this, which you will find how it looks okay, right? I use the normalization, and here is one.
Yes.
If I use this normalization, blah, 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 wrong. Either it is normalized to one, psi zero squared, and then it was okay. Okay? Or I don't have n here, and I normalize it to n. You were right. Okay? You see. When I put n here, it means that I normalize psi 0 to 1. If I don't have this n, it means I normalize to n, and then integral is n. Okay? Yes, obviously. Now it is okay. So, if you want to find 2 mu, then you have, this is 2 mu to power 5 over 2. So it will be 15 gn. Otherwise, we see that mu is r0 squared divided by 2. Yes? So this will be this square. This is 2 mu. So from normalization, you can easily generalize it to an isotropic term, which has 3 different frequencies. Algebra is a bit more complicated, but there is no any fundamental difference. So, if we take a condensate which has 10 to 5th atom, which is 100,000, you see that it will be, I don't know, factor of 10 due to number of particles and the size of the cloud as compared to the grand state of harmonic oscillator. Okay? So it always bothered me, or we will maybe elaborate a bit more, that evidently what you see, the condensate, in the case of interacting system, not in a box, is macroscopic occupation of some state, but not the state, the bare ground state of the trap. This is totally different system, ground state. So I want to add comments about this kinetic energy. Here we have such a sharp edges, because we cut this parabola at this distance where it becomes negative, the density cannot be negative. If we solve the full equation with kinetic energy, for large n, we will see that the solution is like this, except of these regions where we had this edge. So this will be the significant contribution to the shape of the condensate. And why? Obviously, because the kinetic energy, when we look or the momentum, is somehow related to the curvature of the wave function. Okay, it is derivative of the wave function. So at positions where the curvature is big, we can expect large kinetic energy. Okay? And this way I want to introduce some very important quantity which is called healing length. In condensed matter physics, it is often termed coherence length. And this distance we will somehow relate to this region where, okay, the name of the healing length is, when we have uniform system in the box, then it is uniform except at the position of the walls of the box. Here, the density, if this were infinite, the density must go to zero. Okay? If the infinite box, the density drops to zero at the wall. And then there is some characteristic distance after which it heals to the equilibrium value, okay? So it is like a kind of scarf, and then this is after some, so at some distance it comes back to something which would be constant. coherence length. It's the distance at which the kinetic, okay, when we take such characteristic momentum related to this distance, it will be characteristic energy, which will be 2m psi squared. Okay? So this is characteristic kinetic energy. If we equate it to typical potential energy, which is mu, which is g times density, we will find the value of this healing length. Sorry that I'm using this corner, which is not very convenient. So from this we have psi squared is equal to h bar squared divided by 2m gn 1/2. So it is 1 over square root of density. So when we have, you will see vortices in such a system, we will see that the density in the core of vertex goes to zero, and this is characteristic size of the core of vertex in a condensator. And if density is large, this core is small. If it is small, then the size of the vertex is large. So this is the scaling, and this is also something, the deviation is also something at the distance of the healing length. Here kinetic energy becomes comparable to the interaction. Okay, the density drops to zero, the system is not uniform, and here of course by density we mean this density, not the one which is somewhere here. Okay, so this is it about this solution. I want to make a comment on the name Thomas Fermi, because it always bothers me. When I read about Thomas Fermi, it was Thomas Fermi model of multi-electron atom. Okay? That what Thomas Fermi model was invented for, to describe heavy atoms, like uranium or something like this. Fermi needed it. And the idea of Thomas Fermi model was that you have the atom, this is nucleus, which has this potential, which is Cd over R, and then there are some electrons here, which are assumed to have some continuous density, and you want to find some mean field potential for the atom and to find the binding energy of such system. And then what he used was that the Poisson equation, that Laplacian of the potential, is equal to 4 by density. That was the idea, and then you relate, you find, assuming that all states up to here are occupied, and it means that the chemical potential is equal to kinetic energy, Fermi momentum depends on the position, plus this potential which. Okay, this must be constant because at equilibrium the maximal energy occupied by electrons has to not depend on position, because otherwise they would try to go to the regions where this is smaller. Yes, it would be not equal. And therefore you can find the Fermi momentum as 2m mu minus u. This is roughly only a sketch, and then you can relate this Fermi, you can use the Fermi statistics, which tell you that number of that if you integrate up to Fermi momentum, the volume of you assume the Pauli principle that every electron in the phase space occupies the volume of h bar cubed, roughly. Okay, and the volume, if we are forgetting spin, is 4 pi pf squared dpf, and this is volume 2 pi h bar cubed in this is density of electrons on the same row. Okay? So if you find the relation between density, okay, this is momentum, not Fermi. We integrate over momentum, over Fermi sphere up to the Fermi momentum depending on position. So you will find how density depends on Fermi momentum. From this, you will find how density depends on the potential, and you put here equation which will give you the effective potential for radial symmetry. It will be simple universal differential equation, and this is called Thomas Fermi equation. And I think that the origin of the name Thomas Fermi is that density, because from this I can easily find, if you want, 4 pi and m. Of course, mass of electron is missing, 4 pi. I am calculating volume, sorry. 4 pi over 3 Fermi momentum cube divided by 2 pi h squared. So this is this density, and when we put here for Fermi momentum something which is 4 pi divided by 3 2 pi h bar cube, and here I will have 2 m mu minus potential to power 3 half. Okay? So when I put here this potential to power 3 half, I will have equation in the radial. It is simple one-dimensional integration only, because you assume spherical symmetry, so also this is only derivative with respect to distance, second order differential equation. And this is Thomas Fermi equation, which gives the effective potential in many multi-electron atoms. It gives binding energy, it gives scaling with Z, because you have to assume at zero the boundary conditions for this equation to be consistent with this potential, okay, which is not screened. The screening starts when you go away. And then you find some very nice, okay, up to the, if we compare it with sophisticated technique of quantum chemists, it is very bad solution. But if you look at the order of magnitude estimation, it gives, I think, even for helium atom, which has only 2 electrons, not totally wrong, okay, maybe, I don't know, 20% or something more wrong binding energy, but if you are interested in very heavy elements like uranium, for instance, then it is quite okay. Of course, it doesn't give shell effects. So if you look for the scaling with Z at the binding energy, then it oscillates because of the closed shells atoms, and then alkali atoms, there is a big jump. This curve is smooth and gives something on average. And in my opinion, this is the equation which relates density to the potential by some simple algebraic equation. It is the spirit of this Thomas Fermi for electrons. And here we do something similar. We forget this Laplace operator, this kinetic energy, and we relate the potential to the density in some sense. Okay, this is the potential to the density, and the relation is algebraic. I think that this is the justification for the name Thomas Fermi approximation, because nowadays this Thomas Fermi models probably can be found in old-fashioned quantum mechanics textbook, but I think that at least in the field of ultra-cold atoms, everybody who thinks about Thomas Fermi approximation immediately associates this with the Gross-Pitayski equation and neglecting kinetic energy term, which I think historically is wrong. Okay. Thomas Fermi is just from. That's why it is Thomas and Fermi, because this is about electrons, the story. We somehow was borrowed by physicists from ultra-cold gases field that I represent, and of course they are, at least at the beginning, they were always considered by this condensed matter physicists as a kind of ignorance, because they talk about something which is well known already and everything has been done. However, this
relevant, of course, not because of theory, because it's doable. In real life, you can observe it, you can see. So, now I want to spend some time about attractive system. I will be totally quiet. And I want to do some variational analysis of the ground state of this equation. Okay? So I will come back to the equation again. We have minus 1 half kinetic energy, no, without square, plus 1 half r squared plus 4 pi g. I don't know if I want to have this n in the front of equation or in the normalization of the wave function. Prefer to be consistent with my notes, but it is probably not possible to be consistent because I did it in a different way, so whatever. I will put it here. Just. Yes, that's a really good idea. Then we have psi 0 squared times psi 0 is equal to mu psi 0. So, let us do a variational ansatz. So, I assume that psi 0 squared is equal to the Gaussian wave function, okay? Minus r squared by sigma squared, that this is the size of the system. And here I have to normalize it to 1. So it means that I have to have, yes or not. Now I have a question to you. You want me to do the Gaussian integrals or Rayleigh's ones? I can do both. Probably you want me to do this integral. Okay, so it means that psi 0 is 1 over pi to 3 4, to 3 4, I think, sigma to 3 half, e to minus r squared over, I just took a square root.
Is there a face associated?
You can give it a face. You will notice that it will not change anything, because here it is only density, and of course on both sides you can multiply by some global phase which has no any meaning at this moment. However, question about phase is quite essential if you are talking about relative phase. If we have two systems and if we want to observe interference, then we have to say something about phase. However, then I will tell you the anecdote. 1997, 2 years after this experiment, it was a conference in Castelvecchio Pascoli. The conference then was moved by Maciej Levenstein to San Feliu, near Barcelona, Costa Brava. And then it is still, since then, the most important conference which takes place every 2 years. This year is the year of San Feliu conference, with all these, or not all, but the beginning with all Nobel winners coming to this, Nobel winners in the atomic physics related to cold atoms. So it is very prestigious. I am very happy when I am accepted, and I love to have a poster which is extremely hard, because typically 3 people from Poland are accepted only. There are much more applicants than people. Okay, they can be accepted also, more of them, if they work abroad, and then they are considered as Germans or Italians. So, and then it was Juha Javanainen who wrote the paper about the interference of two condensates, but he was talking about many body wave functions and correlations. This is the paper that I like a lot. And then having this big jar of beer in the stage and giving a talk about interference, he said at the end, notice that I were talking about interference and I never used a notion of phase. I never used such notion during entire my talk. The concept of phase is not needed to describe all this interference phenomena. Okay? And then it was late Alan Griffin, who was condensed matter physicist, and they loved the concept of phase because this phase transition to Bose-Einstein condensation is U1 symmetry is broken, and then there is some phase which is attached to the wave function randomly in such a process, but the phase is somehow a signature of the condensation. So it made a lot of discussion. Finally, Alan Griffin suggested that we should vote here in the audience if the condensate has phase or not. Fortunately, people somehow did not participate in the vote. Of course, it's very convenient to use the concept of the phase. It simplifies a lot. However, interference was done because the problem with interference was that this is a system with fixed number of particles. And phase is considered as the conjugate variable to particle number. So there should be such like Heisenberg uncertainty, the relation between phase and number of particles. So if you have number of particles, you don't have phase. Phase is not defined. Phase is whatever. So how come that these two systems having fixed number of particles do interfere? Of course, this is only because people think that in quantum mechanics, the observables are average values over repeated experiments. So if you do like this, that if you do plenty of interferences, you create two condensates, you put them against each other, you take a picture of interference, you repeat it a thousand times, you will have something extremely smooth. However, when you observe it in a single shot, what is possible, as I told you, the technique is that you take a one picture, this instant picture roughly of the condensate. You shine a light going through the condensate, then you put a CCD camera and you see the shadow there. Then you see interference picture. However, from shot to shot, the fringes are totally different positions. When this says condensate has no phase, as it has no energy, well-defined prescribed phase by God. However, as a result of spontaneous symmetry breaking during phase, it gets some phase from shot to shot, and this can be used. However, if you describe the single shot experiment, you can take this many body function and look into high order correlation, and then to say what is probability of finding particles there if I have no particle here and other particle there, then you see very nice interference fringes. And that was really very nice paper of Juhai Amanainen, who showed that this is just because in a single shot you don't observe one particle at once. You observe, in fact, high order correlation. You observe joint probability of one particle being here, the other there, the other yet in another position, etc., etc. And then you observe this, then you see very beautiful modulation of the profile of that probability. Okay, so far so good. Now I have to put this ansatz into expression of the energy, for the energy. So I don't need this, but I need other energy functional, to get the energy as the function of this variational parameter, and try to find the minimum of energy. And of course, with these two terms, I already did it. I showed you what we will get, in fact, that this, so I will make it a bit shorter, this term, okay? You will get that we should. So energy functional is, once more, integral psi 0 star minus 1/2 Laplace operator plus 1/2 r squared psi 0, okay? This is single particle guy, plus 1/2 psi 0 to power 4 times g times n. Yes, because the potential was delta. We had four wave functions with delta potential. With two arguments, x and x prime, and we put x equal to x prime, so that's what we get. And then we have this function, and we should put this into these two integrals. Let me
then to get the expression for energy. So, short, if you want me to do integrations, I will put on a blackboard few integrals. From 0 to infinity, equal values r square a, okay, is equal to 1 half of integral from minus to plus infinity, which is equal to square root of pi over a.
Great.
When integral from 0 to infinity, very often this volume will come here to the play, is minus d over dA. Okay, I will write this 1 half in the front of this. Yes? Because when I differentiate with respect to A, I will get R squared. That's what I like. And this is square root of pi. It was I to minus 1, okay, of square root of pi over A, which is equal to 1 half, and then we have square root of pi. A to minus 1 half, if minus 1 half, the minus will kill this. So we will have another 1 half, so it will be 1 fourth. Yes, a to power 3 over 2. Wow. And then the first integral that I need will be L to power r to power 4, e to minus r squared 2. So I need more showroom. 0 to infinity L r 4. Will be 1 half. And then, again, derivative of what I had here, yes? And I had here 1 half, and then I have square root of pi, and derivative of a to power 3 half minus, will be 3 half, I should sign up correct, 1 over a to power 5 over 2, which is 3 over 8, square root of pi, 1 over 5 over 2. With that, I am happy. The only thing is that I have to do these differentiations, which are ugly, but not so much, because in spherical coordinates, I need only radial differentiation, because nothing depends on angle and integration, and over angles gives me 4 pi. I will have 1 minus r squared, d over dr, r squared, yes, d over dr. That's what I think. Yes? So, and this is Gaussian function, e to minus r squared divided by 2 sigma squared. When I differentiate it with respect to r, I will get d over dr r squared. Differentiation will give me minus r over, no, over sigma squared, yes? So minus, and it will give me something like this. I multiplied it by r squared, and have e to minus r squared to sigma squared. And then I have to differentiate it once more. So I will get 1 over r squared 3 r. Oh no, no, it must be something wrong. Yes, I know that I will. This is d3 r. We give r. Now, in such a situation, under such, I have to look somewhere. Where I have 10 and I shifted it totally. Yes. Okay. R cube. Okay. Maybe it's not so bad. Because when I differentiate it, I will get 3 R squared over sigma. That's okay. I don't believe it. 3r squared divided by sigma squared minus, because then I don't differentiate this, I will differentiate.
this exponent will give me minus r over 2 sigma squared. So to this I will get r 4. Yes? Yes, yes, yes. So this I need.
In the signs of the
pardon?
The signs of like the minus plus.
Minus in the front I didn't I still have minus in the front. You are correct. I still have this minus here. So what I have to do is my energy fractional is now I can safely, of course, there is one thing which is missing, which is this e to minus r squared over 2 sigma squared. So now I have something like this. 1 over pi over 3 half sigma 3 e to minus r squared sigma squared. And then I have minus r squared will go away because I have d3r. So this is r squared. So I will put 4 pi here. For 0 to be. You understand that I have to multiply this by r squared dr 4 pi. All these guys. So this will take away this r squared. Yes? Because of this is just the volume. Minus 3 r squared divided by 3. So this is this kinetic energy. Yes? So what is this kinetic energy? At 1 half. I want it 1 half. Minus 1 half. So I have to have half. So what I have? That's very important because this is nothing else like integral of r squared and r to the power 4. And I know already. So I will put 4 pi divided by 2 pi sigma 1 over sigma to the power 3. And then r squared is 1 over 4 square root of pi. 1 over a to the power 3 half, a is 1 over sigma squared, so it will be sigma cubed. This is this first guy, and it has minus 3 over sigma squared. Yes? Yes. Then we have, how much time do I have? I don't have time. So I have this potential energy, which I will do the same way, and finally I will obtain the energy which is 3 over 4, 1 over sigma squared, don't like 3 over 4 or 4 over 3? That I don't remember. 3, because I had this 3 over 4 sigma squared plus something which will be 1 over sigma 3, and this something will be square root over pi over scattering rate times n, I guess, because it comes together and maybe there is some factor, I don't know. Okay? What is important is that this one is minus, this is plus, and this is plus. Okay? There is something wrong because I want to have negative scattering length. So it means that it is not exactly like this. But maybe I have to take a modulus then. If I want to. I want to finish this, and I have the expression 12. No, that is not square root r. That's good. I have found this expression. Yeah, because of the... This is 2 over pi scatter index times n divided by 2 sigma 3. Well, that's what it is. That's the, now you can see physics is simple and all mistakes can be found when you think about physics, not about formulas. So, think what is possible. Now I will present the graphical solution and that will be that. This is for small distances, the kinetic energy is like this. For small sigma, if sigma is of the order of, it will be like this, and it goes somewhere here. This is potential energy, which goes like this, yes? So, and then, if we add all of them, we will have something probably like this. This will be a sum. Okay? This is kinetic energy, this is V0, and this is T plus V0, and this is what gives the solution for harmonic oscillator. Yes, this will give harmonic oscillator length under sigma, because this is as a function of sigma, yes? I did it by some handwaving. Now we are adding something like this, yes, which is 1 over sigma cube, which is negative and very strong. And when we add this, okay, we can have something like this, depending on the value of n and rs, okay? We will have something good. And, okay, maybe some, because this should go at large distances like sigma squared, yes? And we might have some local minimum and we'll get some radius, which depends on number of particles, okay? However, when we do it for smaller n, for larger n, we will get, well, this is n1 and this is n2. N2 is much larger, it's larger than 1. And then, so okay, I want to conclude. There is some range of parameters where the attractive system in a trap is stable, and this is because of this kinetic energy pressure, of the pressure of due to the non-vanishing momentum due to the curvature of this wave function, okay, the second derivative. So this makes some small barrier, okay, this. However, when we go to very large, larger number of, but the system is always unstable, okay? The system is always unstable. This is plus. This is plus. And that's why I have it. Otherwise I wouldn't have this barrier. This is plus for sure. It was some minus in the front, but definitely it cancelled with another minus. This is to work out at home. So, but if we increase this, so this is minimum, but there is always unstable because there is only barrier and the system can collapse. However, when we increase number of particles, there is no any minimum. So, concluding, small attractive system in a trap are possible for the sodium atoms and parameters of Randy Hilliard, it was 1,400 atoms or something like this, which gives the, one can find the critical value of atoms for a given scattering length, for which the maximum, so the minimum still exists, it becomes shallower and shallower, and then we don't have. So this is analysis of Thomas Fermi approximation, and here it is variational ansatz. You can use it also for the repulsive system. However, repulsive system are much larger and Gaussian ansatz is not very good because it is parabola. Okay, so you see that this is totally different. So, summarizing, we know mean field description, we know Gross-Pitayski equation, we found solutions in the two most important situations for harmonic travel in the box, and we analyze also the stability condition within variational approach to the attractive system. And this variational approach for attractive system is not very bad, because if it is stable, it is always close to the ground state. The shape of this wave function is close to the ground state, and then it collapses. This collapse was observed experimentally, and collapses in the form which was called by Eric Cornell of Bosanova. So it has some names from astrophysics. Thank you very much. That's all for today.